Pat in a minute, but I don't know if you all know, we have an opening act tonight. Molly Lewis is going to come up and perform. She has her CDs for sale outside. If you haven't bought one, you should listen to her stuff and buy some stuff because she's great. Ukulele. First time I met her, John Scalzi had her come and sing Fuzzy Man. And then the next time I met her, she came and totally ruined all my funny remarks by doing a Stephen Fry song. So I told her I get to come up first this time. So please welcome Molly Lewis.
Hello, everybody. I'm Molly Lewis. Man, there are a lot of you.
I did not expect. Okay.
My name is Molly Lewis. I play the ukulele, and I write songs. Obviously with the ukulele, but I also write songs. And this first one is a breakup song. Because as a lady songwriter, you have to write at least one breakup song or they kick you out of the guild. I found a little loophole where there's this one week where I was really mad at Wikipedia. So I decided to write a song about how, like, if Wikipedia were a person and I were to break up with that, I mean, metaphors, you get it. You're a brainy crowd. So this song is called It All Makes Sense at the End. Fact check. When someone puts ideas into your head, Very nice, thank you. But it isn't you, it's me. As of writing that song, Wikipedia and I are back together. So, if you'll indulge me for a second, I would like to plug something. In 3 weeks, at the Triple Door, downtown, I have written a musical. It's called Thanksgiving vs. Christmas, 7 and 10 p.m. showings. Tell your friends. Okay, plug over. This next song is from said musical. And I've actually never played it for a crowd before, but in the 3 minutes that we've known each other, I feel a special bond has formed, and I can trust you. And it's apropos because this song is about pumpkin spice lattes. I'm not kidding. And it's the end of October, which means that pumpkin spice season is coming to a close. And I am pro-Thanksgiving myself, and I see pumpkin spice versus peppermint mocha as the proxy war between Thanksgiving and Christmas. And so when pumpkin spice gets buffaloed, so does Thanksgiving, and that bums me out. So this song is called The Pumpkin Spice Lament. Rest in peace, pumpkin spice. Another month of your company sure would have been nice. But you've gone underground, and eggnog's come around again. It seems that everybody knows that this is just the way that November goes. I think it's rather rude. Pumpkin's a Thanksgiving food. Why can't they coexist? And why can't the seasons overlap? Pumpkin, peppermint, and nog can be the three wise men of flavors. So everybody wins, and I get an extra month to savor. Normal folks, don't think twice, but the time we have together just won't suffice. And there is no excuse, it's not like there's real pumpkin juice. Why must you go away? And why doesn't Starbucks understand? After Halloween is over, I can tell your star is dimming. And I have to just accept that you're the McRib, but for women. But now we're here. What a treat. And the scarcity might be what makes you taste so sweet. But I have to face the facts. You taste like scented candle wax. Dating a website and pumpkin spice lattes. So I think I don't have to preface this one that much. This is a song about Stephen Fry. Because here's the deal. I think Stephen Fry is great. I think he's just a cat's pajamas. But here's the thing. Stephen Fry is gay, which, not that there's anything wrong with that, but it does mean that unless he chooses, he will not have children. And this is a problem. Because he's great, right? We've established. But if somebody doesn't, you know, take initiative, then there will be no fractions of Stephen Fry in the gene pool after Fry. And Sarah Palin has like 8 children, so we gotta step it up. Yeah, somebody should get up in there. So this song is called An Open Letter to Stephen Fry, and it is me offering myself up to a cause that I invented. Thank you. Your heart is promised to a man, and so I have no hope to win it. But consider my proposal, sir. If you can find a minute, I think the future of our species would be better with you in it. I know you have your problems, and maybe I have mine, but you should leave someone to carry on. When you have turned to dust, then plant your genome in an infant, sir. I think it's only just. And you would need someone to bear this child, a woman you can trust. I'll put my body on the line. Mr. Stephen Fry, I see no reason why you wouldn't think it worthwhile to let me bear your child. You would be amazed what science does these days. So think it over and send along your seed. Which I hope you will not doubt. I've got those childbearing hips you always hear so much about. I have permission from my boyfriend, and he'd maybe help you out. Wait, I know it isn't much, but it's what I have to give. I sometimes drink, but I don't smoke, and I eat all my leafy greens. I'll try to go to bed much earlier, get all my vaccines, and I'll put headphones on my belly, and I'll cut back. Actually, in a church very much like this at Harvard University, which was weird, to say the least. He said no. But it's my understanding that I'm the first in line. So, if a song counts as a verbal contract, I am in trouble. So, if Stephen Fry's minions come to my door with like a briefcase and a speculum and say, it's time, then... Let's go. Let's have an adventure. So I have one more song, and it also seemed appropriate for the occasion, because I don't know if you've seen Patrick Rothfuss lately, but he's got quite a beard on him. He's got nothing if not a beard. And this was a song I wrote, not having experience with beard ownership myself, but it's what I imagine owning a beard is like. So it's a product jingle, it's an anthem, it's a very short song. And if you sign up on my mailing list on the other side of that wall over there, you get this song for free, which is cool. Especially if you like beards or have beards, or know anyone that has a beard. So really everybody, this is Seattle. You guys have been awesome. This is the year of the beard. Think of all the great beards that go back through history, like Lincoln, Marx, and Jesus, and Gandalf. A hairy, happy family on a fibrous family tree. The only rhyme with Gandalf was Van Gogh, also bearded. All we are saying is, give beards a chance. You know, I bet all hair wishes it could be in a beard. Am I right, ladies? You know, pubic hair is nothing but a beard inside your pants. I think I just made it weird. Well, let's just sing about it. Beards, they're like an apron on your neck. Beards, they're like a scarf in every season. Beards, they're there to make sure that your collarbones get shade. A fuzzy fringe just for your chin. Sheared, but I myself cannot grow a beard, just as I had feared. But some faces are just engineered for beards, and you may find yourself endeared towards beards. So I recommend that you get nearer to beards and sincerely cheer for beards. It's the year of the beard! Beards, they're like a lion's mane on your face, because they're beards. They're like a horcrux for your manhood. For the party in your mouth. Don't let the hipsters make you cynical. Be your beard short or downright rabbinical. You should show everyone you know it's the year of the
say was anywhere near as funny as half of that. We're not going to take too long to get going. I wanted to ask you guys a couple things. When we get to the part of people stick around for the sign, please do not ask Pat, is his hand hurting? It doesn't really do us any good. It generally is. And please, where's my train of thought there? Please do not ask where book 3 is. I already got a 15-minute lecture from his editor about that question. I've known her for years. I'm really glad he agreed to come out for the slower guard of silent things. We've been making jokes about how that can't be all the stack of his books. It doesn't take up 4 pounds. Other than that, please welcome Patrick Rothfuss.
Shows, for lack of a better word, Paul and Stone, musical comedy duo. It makes them sound like superheroes. They invited me to like come and do some shows with them, and I've done a few here in Seattle and around the country. And they did one, and they kind of invited some more people in, and I said, you know, I think it'd be really fun. I could sing something. You know, instead of just like reading and answering questions like I normally do, if you're gonna have people there, like I could sing something with somebody, like maybe Molly Lewis. And they go, okay, yeah. I go, I know all the words to Tom Lehrer's The Elements song. Because I memorized it back in high school, like you do. Like, that would be funny. I go, do you think she could play it? And the message bounces back, yes, I have the Tom Lehrer ukulele sound songbook. And I'm like, well, okay, great, let's do it. And so I didn't think much more about it until the day of the event. And so we get up there, and she's like, you know, you ready for this? I'm like, yeah, it's great. I've sung it a bunch of times. I used to do it, like, on demand. And for those of you that haven't heard it, it's set to, like, the music of Modern Major General. So it goes like, there's antimony, arsenic, aluminum, selenium, and hydrogen, and oxygen, and nitrogen, uranium, and nickel, iodymium, neptunium, germanium, and iron, americium, ruthenium, uranium. See, I do know the words. Here's the difference, right? Kind of singing it to yourself, or say in a car along with a CD, or when you're mowing the lawn, it's like really different than singing with an accompanist, which I have never done. And so Molly, you know, we're backstage, she's like, you want to run through it? I'm like, we're good. I am on it. I am on it. And so I got up on stage, and then I learned all of those things about, you know, it is different, and boy, there are a lot of you, and actually, you know, I'm not that used to singing into a microphone, and it was a train wreck. It was just like a horrible, horrible train wreck. Luckily, like, Paul and Storm were there, and John Scalzi was actually there acting as the music stand, too, holding her sheet music in his mouth, and she would come around, she'd play it, and I'd be like, that was where I should have come in, right there. And I'd be like, okay, that was it again. It was just, and finally, like, Paul comes out from the wing, and he goes, there's, and he would, like, leave me, and then I could do a verse. But it was a marvelous train wreck. And that was really one of my first intimate performance experiences with Molly Lewis, which I have not yet lived down. But she is absolutely one of my favorite people, and someone who constantly improves the world with her presence. And so those of you that have never heard her before, or heard of her before, I'm so glad that I could bring her to you. And that's the first time I've heard the Pumpkin Spice song, although I've known of the musical she's putting together for a while, and I'm really considering flying out here just so I can watch it. So those of you who live in the area who do not take advantage of that, seriously. Okay, so here's how this is gonna work. I might read some stuff, and then I'll do Q&A, there will be questions which might be asked, and then I will tell a story which may in some way touch on the subject of your question. Let's just be honest, that's how it's gonna work. And then I might read a little something else, we'll go back and forth. In terms of what I read, I'm no Neil Gaiman, much to my endless disappointment. And who's heard Neil read his stuff? Like, or on his, he reads his own audiobooks? He's marvelous. He's like A-plus quality. And I'm like a strong, like, Olympian amateur B. You know? I could listen to Neil Gaiman read a phone book. And the thing that I'm weakest at is reading stuff out of my books, out of my novels. So I'll read a little bit of Slow Regard. That I have a little more practice with because I actually did the audiobook. Because it's shorter. And I realized that if I was going to take a crack at it, I just kind of had to jump in. And the big thing that I learned, you know, I have no problem speaking in front of a group of people, singing to myself in the car, apparently. failing to sing in front of a group of people, that doesn't bug me. And I can read my poetry. I used to write humor columns. I write terrible, excoriating book reviews of Roald Dahl's books. And I can read all of these in public, and it's very easy for me. But reading my books is very different. And it's 10 times different when, instead of in front of a lively crowd of people who have showed up to have fun, you are like in a tight cork-lined room in front of a very expensive microphone, which you are instructed you must not move your head too far to one side or it will screw everything up. And then you slowly learn that you can read a 5-word sentence like 18 different ways. And yeah, that's a pretty terrifying thing to realize when you've already signed the contract. So, has anybody listened to it? How horrible is it? I can't trust you guys to tell me. It might be okay. That's my ringing Midwestern endorsement of my first attempt at doing an audiobook. So, maybe, those of you, you might have gotten questions. They collected some and passed them off to me, so I'll start with these. I should do the thing where I kind of talk about some ground rules here. Do I have my notes? I don't have my notes, I'll have to remember. I'm going to mute my phone. I'm serious, because what will happen is you think, oh, no one's gonna call, and then somebody will, or you get a text, or somebody tweets about you, and what did I just hear? Somebody's text alert was set to the Irish Spring theme song in the plane, and it came up. You know, and everyone's like, whoa, I feel so refreshed in the plane. So what'll happen is I'll be halfway through some story that may or may not tangentially touch on someone's question, and your Irish Spring thing will go off, we will all have a laugh, and I'll pass it off lightly as if it isn't a big deal, although we'll all know that it's a big deal. And I will never remember the end of that story. And you will ride around for the rest of your life with half of that in your head, and you will never get the end of it. And it will make it hard for you to sleep. And then you will die. I'm not saying because of that, but maybe. Eventually you will die and this will happen, probably in that order. There's not a causal relationship. That's a post hoc fallacy. So, I cuss a lot. It's kind of too late. You know, and hopefully, out of curiosity, who reads the blog? No applause. Who has never read the blog? Please, get your hands up. Okay, you guys probably didn't know what you were getting into with this. I'm sorry. If you were expecting somebody in a tweedy jacket who wasn't going to cuss a lot and make inappropriate jokes about monkeys and stuff. Honestly, you're going to be really lucky if the worst you get is inappropriate monkey humor here. So I'm sorry, I don't do it deliberately to offend, but I'll try to ride the break and be civilized, because I know that there are some younger folk here in the audience, but the truth is, if I try to restrain that too much, I sound like I have a speech impediment. Because I look forward into the future about 10 words, and then I see it looming like an iceberg, and I'm like, steer, oh, but the ship has too much momentum, and I brought them, no, and then it. Somebody tweets, Ross Rothfuss was fairly entertaining. However, he had a series of miniature strokes throughout the course of the event. So yes, there will be a little bit of cussing on the horizon, probably. And please be aware that I do not swear because I have a bad vocabulary. I swear because I have an excellent vocabulary. I use every part of the language to its fullest extent. And there are some really delicious words that are just not terribly culturally acceptable. So we got cussing, the cell phone thing. What else do we tend to need to warn people about? What's this?
Pictures.
I was going to wait till the end, but that bears a little bit of discussion. I'm not going to be doing pictures so much anymore. After this, you know, hopefully all of you got the chance to get an already signed book, because that way, if you got a busy day tomorrow, early work, you know, sex to have tonight, you know, whatever, and you don't want to stand in line for 3 hours, you can get your book, go home, and be happy. If you want to stick around, have me personalize it, you know, to Jenny, great. Or your name, it doesn't have to be to Jenny. You know, and that's great. I will happily stay until everyone's book is signed, but there are a bunch of signed ones. Whether or not you got one, you can swap yours out for a signed one to get on with your life. Since I'm guessing most of us are geeks of some flavor or another, you can do the math once you think to do it. With, say, 800 people here at a conservative estimate, if I take 30 seconds in line with everybody and we start at maybe 8:30, it's like a lot. And if we stop to take pictures in there, here's what happens. Do you mind if we get a picture? Oh, sure, that's fine. Okay, here. Hey, would you take a picture? Yeah, no problem. Here. Oh, I use an iPhone. Do you just touch it? Yeah. Okay, here, I just tap it? No, wait. Yeah, I think I bumped it. How do I get back to it? No, it's right here. No, you gotta put your code in. Okay, I'll put my code in. Okay, here. One, two, three. No, it turned itself off again. And I enjoy the goofing off, but it makes the signing like 3 times longer, so the people that are sticking around, they're here for, this signing would last until 3 in the morning. And I've done that, but truthfully, I would much rather have a human interaction with everyone who comes through the signing line, as opposed to spend most of our time like staring at somebody holding a camera. So I'm trying to wean away from that. If this is something that you desperately need, if this is on your bucket list, if you're on a scavenger hunt, whatever, I will do pictures at the very end of everything. So, and as many pictures as your heart desires after the signing line goes, so that everybody who wants a signed book, personalized book, can get that first. Fair?
Yes.
Doesn't really matter if it's fair or not, because that's what we're doing. I think that's about it. Let's do some questions here. If you've already written out a question, you can probably pass them to the center, high school worksheet style, and somebody will come grab them and bring them up to me. What was the most difficult, challenging part of deciding? Oh, that's boring. love your books, but must ask, why is Quoth such an insufferable prick? Kind of surprised you made it through like 750,000 words, not liking the main character. Do you play any instruments? If so, which instruments do you play? I do not play any instruments. I cannot read music. I do not know anything about music. Do you listen to music while writing? No. Do you like music? No, I do not like music. No, if you could choose a superpower, what would it be? Mind control. I would go with the Emma Frost suite of superpowers. Or the Charles Xavier, you know, but No, Emma Frost. I'm okay with that. I don't know if that implies anything about me, but I'm comfortable with that. Oh, well, here is this pop quiz, huh, Chuck? Which bear is the fastest? kind of belligerent here. Let's go for kind of a kinder, gentler question, see if we can find something here. How do you cope with the pressure of a deadline? Badly. How do you find it counterproductive to the creative process? Now, this is something that I could speak on at great length. It's really interesting because I worked on the first book for 14 years before it was published. And I mean, it's not like I spent 8 hours a day on it, but I spent a lot of time on it. And people say, oh, how did you stay dedicated all those years? But they're thinking about it the wrong way. They're thinking that it's like, you know, working in a salt mine. But, like, who has a hobby, right? Who has done this hobby, say, for more than 5 years? How have you stuck with it? It's fun. You know? Like, you know, what do you do for fun?
I play the violin.
Violin. How do you stick with it? And, but ultimately, it brings you joy, right? And see, that's the key. Our hobbies are things that bring us joy. And if you talk to somebody that collects stamps or, like, makes model trains, oh, somebody's recording this. Okay, we need to have a talk about that. Now, what's happening with this?
This is for the bookstore.
Okay, this is for, that means I can have some control over that. Help me remember where we were with this question, okay? Like I said, I didn't have my note card of things to quickly address before we get into the Q&A section. Here's the problem. If this is recorded by everyone here, I have to be a little careful about what I say, because I have to see if, I have to know that no matter what I say, 40 seconds of it can't be taken and put on YouTube and make me look like a total asshole. Because a lot of things that are very funny in context are really horrific out of context. I mean, we've all been there, right? And so if I happen to make a joke about Tolkien, you know, and somebody's recording it and that little snippet goes up there, and then suddenly author Patrick Rothfuss reveals deep-seated hatred for Tolkien, you know, or it's like, Rothfuss hates the Dutch, you know? Rothfuss revealed to be, and I'm like, oh, God. Here's the other thing. And so that makes me a little guarded, and it's fine, I can do that, but that tends to be a different sort of event than if it's, like, just us. Because then, if it's just us, you know, after I get through with some of these, I'll probably go to the audience and people can just shout questions out. And you don't have to worry about asking a question that might be silly or that people might laugh at, because those are the best questions. Because, honestly, and let's be honest here, we could do this like a first date. And if this is on video, that's what we will have as a first date interaction here. Because the purpose of a first date is effectively to prove that you're not a sociopath. And so you say, hello, I have noticed that today weather is occurring. And the other person says, I also have noticed weather. And you say, there are current events which are also in the world. And disasters which are bad. And the other person goes, I also believe disasters are bad. And like slowly you realize that this person isn't gonna skin you and wear your pelt. But like the really good conversations don't happen until like the fifth date or the seventh date. Or on those rare occasions where like you meet somebody and you talk for a while and then it gets kind of like late at night and you're hanging out and it's kind of dark and you talk about things that you normally wouldn't talk about. Who's had that conversation? That's a great conversation. You can be honest with people, you know, on the seventh date or late at night. And the truth is, those of you that read the blog, you know me like way better than a lot of people. Like way better than, honestly, you ever should if I had any sense about what I wrote on the blog. And those of you that haven't read the blog, you still know me in some way very, very well because you've read my books and they're kind of my tangible soul. So we have the opportunity for something more entertaining than a first date meeting here. That said, we are living in a democracy. So we will decide as a group which sort of event we would rather have. If we would like first date, and people can record it and keep it and do whatever you would do with it, which I don't know what you would do with it, but that's your own life. I'm not gonna judge your lifestyle. Or we can jump ahead and have kind of just a moment in time, just us, maybe fifth date conversation. Who wants first date? Be honest. It's okay. Okay, I see a little bit of that. Who would like maybe fifth date conversation? Okay. It's the tyranny of the majority, but it's a fairly crushing majority. So we'll do that. The understanding is that we won't record this. You can record it because I can manipulate the bookstore with, with terror and threats. That said, anybody have any interesting questions now that we got that out of the way? Yeah. What's that? Oh, yeah, yeah, where was I? The creative process, right? That's a good job, thank you for bringing me back. You'd be stuck with half of that answer right in your head, and then you would die. If you put a bunch of kids in a room with a bunch of like cardboard tubes and tape, they will have an awesome time. If you put a bunch of kids in a room with a bunch of cardboard tubes and tape, and then you say, hey, I will give you $5 to make something, they will like crap something out and then go outside so that they can have fun. It's like a weird inbuilt psychological mechanism, and they've done huge studies on it, that like, if you're paid $10 an hour for a job or $5 an hour for a job, sometimes the more you're paid for it, the less you value the work you do, or the, like, you work less hard. I see some people nodding. And I mentioned this in San Diego yesterday, and a woman came up and said, you're absolutely right. I make jewelry as a hobby, and I've got these six beautiful opals on my workbench because somebody commissioned this project, and I haven't touched them in 3 months. Because sometimes when you do this for love, and then somebody gives you money, it jinks up your whole process. And for a long time, for 14 years, this book was what I did just out of love, out of defiance, in all honesty, because I knew it would never be published. And so now, and then I'm still learning how to change gears so that I love doing it, even though it's my job. And sometimes that's easy, and sometimes it's hard. So that's kind of a big mess of an answer. It's not very funny. How much involvement do I have with Nick Podell's narration of the books, and how accurate is the pronunciation? It's pretty accurate. They asked me for the pronunciation of like all the odd words. And from what I hear, Nick Podell has done a great job. I can't listen to the audiobooks because it's like the longest, you know, like listening to yourself on the answering machine. It's like 36 hours of that. It's something way worse because I've read it to myself in my head a million times and I hear it and I'm like, no, 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 no! It's not that it's not good, it's that it's not that. It's not what's in here. So, any questions about specific pronunciations? I'll do a real quick battery.
In the audiobook, Nick Podell
I sense there's money writing on this. Honestly, that one I could go either way with. And I say that I'm not going to bullshit you because I've probably said it both ways myself. Boy, that's just going to wreck your whole day, isn't it? I can tell. I see like the deep sadness in you, Debbie. Mostly Debbie. There we go. Yeah. The thing in the tree is the cafe. Denna, Kvothe, Imri, Eladin.
What's the drink they drink at the...
Metheglin.
Metheglin.
Yeah.
If Auri and Eugene?
Sure. a lot of the foreign languages, they gave those to me, and I read them into a phone, and they recorded them to play them back for the translator, and I did each of them 3 times, and a lot of it... Like a lot of the Siaru I made specifically so that it was very readable, so it was a real language. But some of the other language I made specifically to be alien, like, some of the things that I made to be very specifically alien, on the off chance that somebody still hasn't read the first book. And so I got to that and I had to read it, and I'm like, oh, okay, I'm gonna pay for it now. Yeah. Yeah, but they took great care to get that information from me. Did Robert Jordan's Wheel of Time influence In the Name of the Wind? Yeah, maybe a little bit, but I've only read the first 2 books, and that was 20 years ago. This isn't a question. I'm curious, though. I think that you are really cute. I would like to run barefoot through your beard. Call me at home. And you don't know if I'm lying. Could I sing a round of Tinker Tanner? I could. Besides Catan, what's my preferred board game? I really like Agricola. It's a solid game if you're a resource manager game sort of person. I should read something. What should I read? I can read A Piece of Slow Regard. I used to write humor columns from the local paper, which have the benefit of being humor, you know, and they're bite-sized, and you won't see them anywhere else. I usually bring along some poetry just to settle arguments when people think that I'm some sort of poetry-hating monster. And while I may be, that does not preclude the fact that I have written poetry in the past. What else do I potentially have here? I have an excoriating review of Roald Dahl's book. Because somebody emailed me and said, I'm one of the top-ranked reviewers on Goodreads, and somebody says, your average review is like 4.8, you know? Like, so are you just like shilling for your friends, or do you have no taste? And I'm like, that's not an unreasonable conclusion based on that evidence. But what it really is, you know, if I just like review a book, I mean, first off, why would I review a book and go, it was kind of meh? You know, it's like, well, thank you for sharing your ambivalence, you know? It's not really helpful. And if a book is awful, it's really rude to just like take a big duke on somebody's book. Especially because did that terminology confuse people? Sorry about that. So I was trying to avoid saying take a shit. So yeah, I should just go with my natural impulses. The truth is that you have a kind of a small world in publishing. And if I tear into somebody's book, I mean, that person has friends, and they have editors and PR people and an agent. And first off, it's rude. But second off, you've just kind of pissed off a whole bunch of people you might have to work with in the future. And so why borrow trouble? But that said, sometimes a book is really awful. So I wrote a review of Roald Dahl's book, because he's dead. and because sometimes I have strong opinions that I want to share. And also because he's way too big for him to be ever hurt by me throwing stones at, you know, the monolith that is his collected work. So I've got that here, too. What sounds good? Both? There were four options, so both. Having some sort of platonic law of excluded middle fallacy thing happening there, I don't know. Okay, so how about this? Humor column? Who wants a humor column? Who wants me to pick on Roald Dahl? Who wants, was it poetry?
Yeah.
Yeah, nobody wants poetry. There's always like one person really excited about it, and I always feel bad for that person. Or I could read a little bit of Slow Regard. Yeah. It seems like the humor column was the winner there. Let's see what I've got. Who's heard the guinea pig one? Guinea pig? Okay, so I don't think I'll do that. Let me see. Got one. Why does my boyfriend never call me? See, it started out as an advice column, and then about the third week, it became a humor column. Because I would just kind of make fun of the people that wrote in. They knew eventually. This one's called Good Girls Don't Lick Doorknobs. I don't remember what that's about. Oh, yeah. Am I cheating? Well, that seems like some fairly self-evident. Yeah, how about this one? Who's heard the one where, why does my boyfriend never call me? Have I done that here before? Only a few. Okay, that'll be a good one. A peek at the time here. The letter is as follows. Hello, young Rothfuss. This was a while ago. I've been wondering about men lately, in particular, boyfriends. I've been asking my gaggle of girlfriends why women have attachment issues. That's not your question. I want to know why most males in a relationship like to play games with us. For example, I'm not going to call her for a couple of days to see if she cracks and calls me first, or is it that they just deal with distance better than us women? Nice use of us, that's the appropriate grammatical phrase. My friend and I call our condition the kiss and cuddle syndrome. The only reason we go back to our loser boyfriends is because we want to hold them and kiss them and squeeze them until their heads pop off. I'm rambling now, but why does my boyfriend who lives in Minneapolis not call me, damn it? And it's signed Anitra. Well, Anitra, I have a good answer to your question. Actually, I have two good answers. Luckily, due to a psychotic break brought about by midterm stress, I have two fully formed personalities willing to give you their opinions on this vital issue. Evil Pat's response. Keep in mind, these were written like 20 years ago. So, why are guys thoughtless, callous, game-playing jerks? Simple, Anitra, because that's what women have trained us to be. Let me explain with a story. Imagine you're a young boy, and like most young boys, you're a nice guy. Innocent, polite, considerate. You meet Julie. She's funny, smart, and pretty. You become friends, and slowly but surely, you realize you're in love with her. So you join forensics because she's on the team. You cheer her on when she tries out for the swim team. Soon, you're talking on the phone for hours at a stretch, really getting to know her. But while you're investing time and energy into building an emotional and intellectual bond with Julie, some basketball player asks her to prom. She says yes, of course, because he's a junior and he has his own car. Plus, he's got an ass you can bounce a quarter off of. Let's call him Chad. Then Chad proceeds to treat Julie like crap because he doesn't know the first thing about her. But for some reason, she clings to him like he's the last life preserver on the Titanic. And all the while, there you are, her friend and confidant. And every night, you're on the phone listening while she cries about how obnoxious and thoughtless he is. But she forgives him because she's in love, right? And then it dawns on you. Julie will never be your girlfriend. Why? Well, given the overwhelming evidence, Julie doesn't want a boy who listens to her thoughts and feelings. Julie wants a cretin with a nice ass. Guys like Chad get all the love. Guys like you are the equivalent of an emotional tampon. End of story. Now, if you're a really nice guy, you move on with your innocence intact. Then you meet a girl called Erica. Lather, rinse, repeat. Repeat, repeat. And after you slide down this emotional razor blade about a dozen times, you know what you get? Me. I'm not nice anymore. Over the years, I've molded myself into an arrogant bastard of such vast proportions that women find me irresistible. And you know what? It works great. You can get radiation burns from the amount of raw animal magnetism I throw off. And now you're complaining that your guy doesn't call you? Get bent, chickie. You women have made your collective bed, and now you have to lie in it, alone. Guess what was going on in Pat's life at this point? Here we have nice Pat's response. I like how we don't have evil Pat and good Pat here. We have evil Pat and nice Pat. It kind of implies that there's no good Pat at all. Well, Anitra, your letter reminded me of a conversation I had with a friend about a week ago. She told me that she liked getting massages. More than that, she considered them essential to her emotional well-being, especially when she was in between boyfriends. She went on to explain that she thought touching and being touched was a vital part of being a primate, which means, in a nutshell, that she feels like her inner monkey occasionally needed some love. Personally, I couldn't agree more. I think that deep down, we all have basic monkey urges. Do you remember that? Settle down, all right. We'll have a dick joke eventually, right? And I'm gonna make it, because I'm at the podium in church. If I would have planned this better, I would have snuck in some dry ice and kind of secreted it somewhere and like busted it open. So like during Evil Pat's response, I would slowly start to smoke and pretend not to notice. And, oh, next time. Personally, I couldn't agree more. I think that deep down, we all have basic monkey urges. Do you remember that experiment we all learned about in Psychology 110? The one where the baby monkey had to choose between two fake mom monkeys? Do they still teach this?
Yeah. Yep.
Right. So given the choice, for those of you that fail Psych 110, given the choice between a non-cuddly mom made out of chicken wire that had milk and a furry fake mom that didn't have any milk at all, the baby monkey always chooses the furry mom. This goes to show how important this cuddling impulse is to us primate types. So to answer your question, Anitra, I decided to perform an expanded version of this experiment. I added a balsa wood monkey with a cookie and a handgun, a sheet metal monkey that gives out bong hits. We're going to license it eventually, and you can buy one then. And a monkey made entirely out of Cool Ranch Doritos that gets drunk and burns you with cigarettes. Oh, that's not funny. That's not funny. I wrote this before I was a dad. That's not funny. That's a little bit funny. But really not funny. Anyway, to make a long story short, I never got around to finding a baby monkey to experiment on. Apparently you need a permit or something for that. But I can tell you that my favorite was the razor wire monkey with a taser that dispensed sweet, sweet methadone. I still sleep with that one at night. What's the moral to this story? I have no idea. Scientists hate monkeys, I guess. There's your moral. I'm out of here. Spring break. So you could tell I was writing to a very specific word limit there. I did not have time for a conclusion because I got wordy in my monkey fantasy. Now, it's also, let's not applaud this horrifying piece of flawed rhetoric. I feel the need to mention here, because I am a much different person now than I was when I wrote this. You know, Evil Pat's response is a little funny, but it's funny for a wrong reason. It's funny because it's casting in very sharp relief kind of an underlying concept that effectively women are around, and if you're nice to them for a while, then eventually they're obliged to have sex with you. And not to get all serious all of a sudden, but this is like a really big problem in our society. I heard it said really, really well once, because there's the concept of the friend zone, right? Which, now people kind of lambast the entire concept, but it's true. I mean, you can get put in the friend zone, and I have had women that have been friends and they've been interested, but I've just thought of them as friends. It goes both ways. The difference is when a guy gets put in the friend zone, a lot of times they have like this weird, like they feel like they have been wronged. Like somehow the universe is not turning in the appropriate way that it's designed to. And a lot of times, this is because the stories that we read perpetuate this kind of cultural myth. And let's take it all the way back, like as far as you can go. I don't want to talk about Gamergate. But we're gonna, okay? We're gonna touch on it just a little bit, right? Because if I don't, then it's just and raw cowardice. Let's take it all the way back to Frogger, okay? A game so crude and so far away that hopefully we can all have some emotional distance from it. You're trying to get your frog from this end to this end, right? You jump over in there and you get the points. I think you got points, right? How do you get extra points? Who remembers? There's a female frog up there, and if you jump on her, you get extra points. What does this teach us? It's like, if she's there and you get there, woo. It's like, that's her only purpose in the game. First off, it lets you know that you are playing a dude frog. And you know that you're not a lesbian frog because she has a bow in her hair and you don't. Right? See, I saw you going there. You're like, but maybe. No. And so what does this say? First off, if you're playing this game, you're a boy. Second off, if you just need to get, there's a woman, and if you get there, it's extra points. Because you're obviously doing what happens when you're a frog and you jump on another frog. And that's it. You know, there's no dialogue options there. It's no, like, you know, quick time event where you take her out to coffee or anything like that. how am I going to bring this around? I heard it said once in a much, much better than I would ever be able to say it briefly, where somebody was whinging on about the friend zone. And believe me, I have spent so much time friends with women who have had no interest in me at all, right? That's actually where I'm most comfortable in a relationship, because I just have the most practice at it. And it sucked. It sucked a lot. But that doesn't mean that they did anything wrong. It doesn't mean that I was owed something. What it means is that, like, I needed to somehow bring something of value to this relationship, you know, to make myself interesting to them. Like, maybe work out a little bit, you chubby bastard, you know? How about practice a little personal grooming, you know? Learn how to flirt. What this person said is the concept of the friend zone implies that women are sexual slot machines that you insert kindness coins into until they pay out sex. And I heard that and I went, that is exactly what the culture teaches us. You know, you strive and you strive and strive and eventually, you know, well, okay, your princess wasn't in this castle. You know, your princess wasn't in this castle. Well, okay, you'd only talk to her 3 times in Mass Effect, but I bet you if you talk to her 4 times, oh, yep, okay. Now you get to have the sexual cutscene. And there's no way you can fail at that. And that's a little sad. The end. The end. I don't want to talk about that anymore. Actually, I want to talk about it a lot more, but this is not necessarily the place for it. Okay, now that I've really brought everyone down, killed the mood. Did I see some of the note cards get passed up to the front here? Or we can just pick from the audience if anyone has questions. Yes?
Can I ask 2 questions?
You can ask one first, just one at a time.
Okay, what's the word that you always, like, there are a few words that I never can spell, and every time I spell them, they always, what are yours?
Intelligence. The word that I can't, yes, what words you constantly misspell? Weird. It's got weird spelling. And I always think, I know it's spelled weird because it's weird, but then I misspell it backwards double. You know, it's the IE, you know, and so I can never do it. Also intelligence. And no word makes you look dumber than misspelling intelligence. Also, college. So, yeah, I do not, that's led to me making a really bad impression a lot of times. You misspell intelligence and college in the same sentence, and you're not getting that job. Way in the back. Yep, beard. That is a geek question. Do you notice how he stipulated? Like, if you could have a voice, but you can also turn it off at will, and they're just gonna give you advice. Because you're used to asking that question of other geeks, and other geeks have said, I wouldn't do it because they could just talk to me all the time and I'd go crazy, they'd wake me up at night. So you've already built that into the question. Okay, we hang out with the same sort of people. So let me tell a story vaguely touching on the subject of your question. A lot of times authors say something that really gets to me. They say, my characters just took over the story. I'm gonna take a deep breath. I'm gonna set that whole thing aside. I'm not gonna go off on that particular tear. And I'm gonna talk about Philip K. Dick. Who, God bless Philip K. Dick, right, and his really sad life, you know, because he had kind of a miserable time, and dude was like all the way crazy. Super, all the way super crazy. Like no fooling, no faking, crazy, crazy. And But which is not to say that he did not write some awesome stuff. Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep is like one of the best speculative fiction works ever. And if you haven't read it and you've seen Blade Runner and so you think, why bother, then you are part of the problem, right? Don't bring that weak shit around here. What was I talking about? I raged myself out there. I got it. So, I got this story secondhand, but apparently, Philip K. Dick was always kind of hurting for money. He was never a huge success. All of that came afterwards when his movie, when Blade Runner broke, and suddenly he was huge. And so his life was kind of always a mess because, like, huge schizophrenic and poor and struggling writer and crazy. And so when he would be in a big mess, he would sit down and he would ask advice of one of his characters that was way smarter than him. At the typewriter, he'd sit down and he'd go, "Oh, Jesus, Ed, I'm in a hell of a mess." I would say, "Well, what's going on, Phil, you know?" He says, no, just explain it to me. He would do the dialogue back and forth between him and the character would give him advice. Which I'm not using as an example of him being crazy. I'm using as an example of him being a writer. Because who's done some writing? Who has written something and afterwards you read it and you're like, whoa, I don't remember writing that at all. And you don't need to be a writer to have that happen. Who's written an email? And you go back, you read it the next day and you're like, oh, I was so angry. Oh, I had not had my morning coffee. Oh, my blood sugar was low. Who would I pick to have in my head, a fictional character? I might pick Auri. I think Auri might like have, you know, I've got enough quoth in my own personality. Like, I'm a good problem solver, I'm fairly quick on my feet, I'm articulate, I'm sexy, you know, I'm a wizard. Really good at science and math, and can spell any word perfectly the first time, and got a lot of red hair. But, you know, like, having Quoth in my head talking to me would be like having a snarkier, more irritating me giving me advice that I already know is right, which is just so irritating when somebody tells you something you already know is right. He's like, "You should not go on tour. You should just skip that convention, stay home with your kids, and get some exercise, fat ass, because, I mean, seriously, it's bad for your health." I'm like, shut up, I know, God. And Auri would just say, like, "Rainbows taste like giggles." And I'm like, "Thank you, Auri, thank you. Thank you. That has actually improved my day, thank you. That is what I needed. Fuck you, folks." That's the other reason I turned this advice column into a humor column, because if you give good advice, like, nobody likes that. Nobody wants good advice. And so usually what I would do is I would go in and I would give people terrible advice and say, "What should I do?" And I'm like, "Here's what you do. Rather than having an intelligent conversation with your girlfriend, just cheat on her." But, like, don't do it dumb, right? Cheat on her, like, the bit, like, with her sister. So not just any, the sister she's living with. You know? And then they would go, "God, that's the dumbest advice ever. I'll just talk to her." Ding! There you go. Single-handed invented the discipline of reverse psychoanalysts, or psychotherapy, and just tell people the worst possible option and they will default to something else. Okay, what do we got here? What would I do if I were invisible for a day? That is such a dangerous question. That's actually, I have never really considered it. What would I really do? I would sneak around and watch people. I would watch what people do when they're alone. Yep. Yep. Absolutely. Absolutely. Because, like, it's one thing, like, if you're a writer of a certain sort who is very intent on character, you're, it's not that you think, I want to write good character. What happens is you're a certain person that is very interested in people. And that turns you into a character writer. And so I'm really curious about people, and I excuse it by saying it's research. But, you know, even if you meet people and you watch them, or if you see two people and they're in a cafe, or you see one person and they're just by themselves in a cafe and you're kind of watching them to see how they behave because you're curious, they still are in public, or they're still in a pair. But, like, watching what somebody would do, like, alone at home, because the only person you ever really know what they do at home alone is you. And that's a really disturbing data point for me. I know that you can't live like me or society would collapse. I am barbarous. I am a bear with a thin veneer of civilization painted over me. Should I read something else?
Yes.
What time do we have here? We have time. I could read the book review. Now, I'm going to preface this. Nah. I have a weakness for preface that I'm trying to curb. Says the man who has written a trilogy that is effectively a prologue. Sorry, I gave away the secret there. I wrote my first high school novel, and somebody said, God, Pat, this is, who saw the movie, was it called Funny Farm with Chevy Chase in it? And he wrote his book, and then he handed the manuscript to his, he's like, would you read it? She's like, sure. And he pulls up a chair and just sits. And he makes her read it in front of him. And she's like, I don't know, it's, you've got like a flashback and there's a flash forward. I think there's a flash sideways here too. That was my high school novel. It had two dream sequences and a flashback, and it, thing was like 80 single spaced pages long, and all that happens in the story is that they move from one bar to another. And so what do I do to correct this problem, right? I write a fantasy trilogy where the whole thing is a flashback and they don't even go to another bar. Nothing is more horrifying to me than a writer who emails me and says, you're such a role model. You're such an, I thought I was crazy for working on my book for 9 years. And I say, no. I don't know. Don't. I succeeded despite everything that I have done. Every choice that I've made has pretty much been a stupid choice. And that's not just about writing. It's like, I will, that's a blanket statement for my entire life. That's the title of my autobiography right there. Okay, here we go. Fuck this book. Don't read it to your kids. That's the short version. If you want the longer version, settle in. We're gonna have a bumpy ride. Also, there's spoilers here and some cussing and some indignation. Be warned. I've always thought of myself as a bit of a Roald Dahl fan. I read the BFG growing up, and I loved it. I watched Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and I loved it. But recently, my love dimmed a little when I read James and the Giant Peach, a book that was a serious boatload of meh. A nickel's worth of story in a dollar-long book. And don't you dare say, oh, it's just a children's book, or kids don't know any better, or you can't hold young adult fiction to the standards of, stop, okay, just stop. That's such bullshit that it's an insult to the word bullshit. Kids' books should be just as good as any other books, if not better. They should be held to a higher standard than other literature for the same reason that we take extra care with children's food. The fact is, what you feed your kids is important, and that includes what they put in their heads as well as what they put in their bellies. So let's talk about this book, SEO Trot. In this story, you have Mr. Hopper. Who's read this book, by any chance? Wow, okay. Who, like, loved it growing up, and I'm gonna, like, shatter your childhood like a fragile pane of glass? Welcome to the show. I should have asked that question first. In this story, you have Mr. Hopper. He loves two things: the flowers he grows on his balcony and his downstairs neighbor, Mrs. Silver. He's terribly lonely, and he's terribly shy. His downstairs neighbor, Mrs. Silver, has a pet tortoise that she adores. The tortoise is named Alfie. He lives on Mrs. Silver's balcony, and Mr. Hoppy is terribly jealous of him. One day, Mrs. Silver laments to Mr. Hoppy. They talk while they're on their balconies, she with her turtle and him tending his garden. And I know there's a difference between a turtle and a tortoise. Let's not get into that. She's had Alfie for 11 years, and he's still tiny. She wishes he would get bigger. I'd give anything to make that happen, she says. Mr. Hoppy gets all Twitter-pated hearing this, and so he lies to her, telling her that he knows a magic spell that will help her tortoise grow. And I quote, "I beg you to tell me, Mr. Hoppy, I'll be your slave for life." When he hears the words, "your slave for life," a shiver of excitement swept through Mr. Hoppy. End quote. So he gives her some bullshit he makes up, telling her it's a spell he learned from a Bedouin. And then he goes out and buys 100 tortoises. Then he builds a long grabber arm of the sort that you would use if you wanted to, say, steal someone's tortoise off the balcony right below yours. And at this point, I thought to myself, he's not doing what I'm thinking, is he? And then I flipped a couple of pages and told my son that it was bedtime and we'd finish the book tomorrow. Disappointed, he went to bed. I finished the book. Here's what happens. Mr. Hoppy spends the next 2 months slowly replacing Mrs. Silver's pet with progressively larger tortoises. Mrs. Silver is amazed by this, of course, and out of gratitude, she marries Mr. Hoppy. In the context of our previous discussion, you're seeing a theme here? God, I could not have planned that better. Then Mr. Hoppy gives away all of the tortoises, including Alfie, Mrs. Silver's pet of 11 years. Do I need to explain to anyone how fucked up this is? Do I feel bad for Mr. Hoppy, this lonely, shy man? Do I empathize with the fact that he loves someone but can't bring himself to tell her? Yes, I have been Mr. Hoppy. For most of my life, I've been Mr. Hoppy. Sure, I empathize, but his actions are fucking awful here. And their matter-of-factness makes them doubly awful because it implies... It seems to say, hey there, lads, love a girl? Here's what you can do. Lie to her, trick her, steal from her, make her obligated to you, and then you get to be in a relationship. And that's not even touching on the subject that Mrs. Silver is shown to be a complete fucking idiot who recites a magic spell 3 times a day to make her tortoise grow, and then fails to notice when her beloved pet of 11 years is exchanged for a completely different animal, not just once, but several, several times. Suffice to say that the next night, when my boy asked to read the rest of the story, I deviated from the original script. This was made a little more difficult by the fact that the book is heavily illustrated. Even so, I was fairly confident I could do better than Dahl's original trick her into marrying you storyline. In my version, in addition to buying a bunch of tortoises and building a tortoise grabber, Mr. Hoppy also goes to the grocery store and buys a bunch of vegetables. Then he spends the rest of the week inventing recipes for tortoises and testing them on his new pets, figuring out which ones are the most delicious to tortoises. Then, every night, He uses his long-arm tortoise grabber to lift Alfie up to his apartment, where he feeds him delicious food. And as we all know, when you eat more, the bigger you get, right? I know that. At that point, my son goes, "Daddy, that's why you're so plump." I explained to him early on that it wasn't polite to call a person fat. I say, when a person is fat, you say that they're plump. And I just told him once, and ever since then, it's always what he says. He says, "Oh, Dad, you were looking very plump today." You know, there's no value judgment attached at all. He's just like, "You are plump." It's like the sweetest slap in the face. So, Mr. Hoppy discovers that what Alfie likes best is some of the flowers that Mr. Hoppy grows on his balcony, the flowers that Mr. Hoppy loves. So Mr. Hoppy uses those flowers from his garden in his recipes. I describe these to my boys in some detail to pad out the story, because I am a fantasy author after all. Mr. Hoppy feeds Alfie every night, and Alfie grows bigger and bigger and bigger. Finally, Mrs. Silver is overcome with joy and invites Mr. Hoppy down to her apartment to show off her lovely tortoise. She thanks Mr. Hoppy for his magic spell and asks him if he'd like to have tea. Over tea, Mr. Hoppy says, "Miss Silver, I have a confession to make." "Yes," she says. "That spell wasn't really magic," he said. "I just made it up." "Really?" Mrs. Silver said. "Yes," Mr. Hoppy said. "I've been feeding Alfie special recipes every night so he would grow bigger." "Oh, Mr. Hoppy," Mrs. Silver said. "I already knew that. But I'm so glad you told me yourself." "You knew?" he said. "You silly man," she said. "The balcony is right outside two huge windows." "Just like yours is. How could I not see you grabbing him every night?" "Ah," Mr. Hoppy said, feeling rather embarrassed. He thought he was being very clever. "You're right, of course. I did. You caught me. But I did it because I love you. I knew that Alfie was really important to you, and I wanted you to be happy." "I know that too," Mrs. Silver said. "I'm so glad you're finally brave enough to tell me." And then they get married. I would have preferred to have them go out to coffee or have a date instead, but there was a picture of them getting married in the book, so I had to leave that part in. In my version, they also worked together to publish a book of recipes for tortoises. And then they used that money to start a tortoise park where Mr. Hoppy put his now his 100 now surplus to requirement pets. But apparently I was pushing my luck. When I told him that last part, my boy gave me a look. "Did you make that up?" he asked. "Ah," I said, "you're right, of course. I did. You caught me. But I did it because I love you." So we got a little bit of a late start, and then Molly did her thing. It's been a little more than an hour, and I'm having a good time. You guys are a lovely audience. But I know people have busy lives, and I've got some books to sign. So thank you all so much for coming out. I really can't thank you enough for doing this. Now, before everybody heads out, we're going to try to structure this chaos a little bit. If you need to go, you can go. Okay? If you need to go, you can go. Or if like really you've been having to pee for a while, that's okay. But what we don't want is like a mad rush for everybody to get to stand in line at the same time, because that's not how it's done. You in the balcony, I'm watching you too. First things first, people with kids and babies, can we agree that they get to the front of the line? Okay. Thank you. Second thing, Folks who have trouble getting around, anybody who's got a disability and just can't stand in line for a bunch of hours, can we say that's cool too? Okay. We're on the road to civilization. I'm proud of you people. Third thing, now this is the tricky one. People who maybe drove 2 hours to get here. Did anybody drive 2 hours to get here? 3 hours to get here? 4 hours to get here? Okay, yeah. Here's 6 hours to get here. Someone flew from South America to get here. If you are heading back tonight, can we agree that those people who have a long trek ahead of them can come to the front of the line? Now, this is where it gets dangerous, because this is where civilization has the potential of falling apart. Where do liars go? To Washington, D.C. Do you want to go to Washington, D.C.? No, you don't. So, we're operating on the good faith system. If you have to drive like 2-3 hours, you can get dibs on the front of the line. You know, if you're staying here tonight, that does not count. Okay, if you already have a hotel room, you're crashing with a friend, let's not abuse this trust that the lovely audience has extended. I have a question.
Yeah, if we really want to meet you at some point, but our moms are in town and they're already mad that you're doing this, are you going to be back in Seattle soon?
I love Seattle. I come back here all the time. I think I'm going to be probably hitting Emerald City Comic Con. And when I do that, I'm probably going to do an event with Paul and Storm. And I'll be hanging around there, and by necessity, that will be a smaller venue. So it's just a matter of time. If you really, please don't feel like this is your only chance to catch me. I will be back. I love Seattle. There's a bunch of people here that I love hanging out with. So you will have a future chance to see me. I will make myself available. That said, if you do want to get something signed tonight, be my guest. I will be here until everyone is happy, okay? Oh, hold on, one more question. I will probably bring those up to the thing, yes. Thank you all so much for coming. But wait for the big announcement. Wait.